Dubliners by James Joyce. North Richmond Street, being blind, was a quiet street, except at the hour when the Christian Brothers School set the boys free. An uninhabited house of two stories stood at the blind end, detached from its neighbours in a square ground. The other houses of the street, conscious of decent lives within them, gazed at one another with brown, imperturbable faces. The former tenant of our house, a priest, had died in the back drawing room. Air, musty from having been long enclosed, hung in all the rooms, and the waste room behind the kitchen was littered with old, useless papers. Among these, I found a few paper-covered books, the pages of which were curled and damp. The Abbot, by Walter Scott, The Devout Communicant, and The Memoirs of Vidocq. I liked the last best because its leaves were yellow. The wild garden behind the house contained a central apple tree and a few straggling bushes, under one of which I found the late tenant's rusty bicycle pump. He had been a very charitable priest. In his will, he had left all his money to institutions and the furniture of his house to his sister. When the short days of winter came, dusk fell before we had well eaten our dinners. When we met in the street, the houses had grown somber. The space of sky above us was the colour of ever-changing violet, and towards it the lamps of the street lifted their feeble lanterns. The cold air stung us, and we played till our bodies glowed. Our shouts echoed in the silent street. The career of our play brought us through the dark, muddy lanes behind the houses, where we ran the gauntlet of the rough tribes from the cottages, to the back doors of the dark, dripping gardens where odours arose from the ash pits, to the dark, odorous stables where a coachman smoothed and combed the horse or shook music from the buckled harness. When we returned to the street, light from the kitchen windows had filled the areas. If my uncle was seen turning the corner, we hid in the shadow until we had seen him safely housed. Or if Mangan's sister came out on the doorstep to call her brother into his tea, we watched her from our shadow peer up and down the street. We waited to see whether she would remain or go in, and if she remained, we left our shadow and walked up to Mangan's steps resignedly. She was waiting for us, her figure defined by the light from the half-open door. Her brother always teased her before he obeyed, and I stood by the railings, looking at her. Her dress swung as she moved her body, and the soft rope of her hair tossed from side to side. Every morning I lay on the floor in the front parlour, watching her door. The blind was pulled down to within an inch of the sash, so that I could not be seen. When she came out on the doorstep, my heart leapt. I ran to the hall, seized my books, and followed her. I kept her brown figure always in my eye, and when we came near the point at which our ways diverged, I quickened my pace and passed her. This happened morning after morning. I had never spoken to her, except for a few casual words, and yet her name was like a summons to all my foolish blood. Her image accompanied me even in places the most hostile to romance. On Saturday evenings, when my aunt went marketing, I had to go to carry some of the parcels. We walked through the flaring streets, jostled by drunken men and bargaining women, amid the curses of labourers, the shrill litanies of shop boys who stood on guard by the barrels of pigs' cheeks, the nasal chanting of street singers who sang a camellia about O'Donovan Rossa, or a ballad about the troubles in our native land. These noises converged in a single sensation of life for me. I imagined that I bore my chalice safely through a throng of foes. Her name sprang to my lips at moments in strange prayers and praises which I myself did not understand. My eyes were often full of tears. I could not tell why. And at times a flood from my heart seemed to pour itself out into my bosom. I thought little of the future. I did not know whether I would ever speak to her or not, or if I spoke to her, how I could tell her of my confused adoration. But my body was like a harp, and her words and gestures were like fingers running upon the wires. One evening, I went into the back drawing room in which the priest had died. It was a dark, rainy evening, and there was no sound in the house. Through one of the broken panes, I heard the rain impinge upon the earth, the fine, incessant needles of water playing in the sodden beds. Some distant lamp or lighted window gleamed below me. I was thankful that I could see so little. All my senses seemed to desire to veil themselves, and feeling that I was about to slip from them, I pressed the palms of my hands together until they trembled, murmuring, "Oh, love! Oh, love!" many times. At last, she spoke to me. When she addressed the first words to me, I was so confused that I did not know what to answer. She asked me, was I going to Araby? I forgot whether I answered yes or no. It would be a splendid bazaar, she said, and she would love to go. And why can't you? I asked. While she spoke, she turned a silver bracelet round and round her wrist. She could not go, she said, because there would be a retreat that week in her convent. Her brother and two other boys were fighting for their caps, and I was alone at the railings. She held one of the spikes, bowing her head towards me. The light from the lamp opposite our door caught the white curve of her neck, lit up her hair that rested there, and, falling, lit up the hand upon the railing. It fell over one side of her dress and caught the white border of a petticoat, just visible, as she stood at ease. "It's well for you," she said. "If I go," I said, "I will bring you something." What innumerable follies laid waste my waking and sleeping thoughts after that evening! I wished to annihilate the tedious intervening days. I chafed against the work of school. At night in my bedroom and by day in the classroom, her image came between me and the page I strove to read. The syllables of the word Araby were called to me through the silence in which my soul luxuriated, and cast an eastern enchantment over me. I asked for leave to go to the bazaar on Saturday night. My aunt was surprised and hoped it was not some Freemason affair. I answered few questions in class. I watched my master's face pass from amiability to sternness. He hoped I was not beginning to idle. I could not call my wandering thoughts together. I had hardly any patience with the serious work of life, which, now that it stood between me and my desire, seemed to me child's play, ugly, monotonous child's play. On Saturday morning, I reminded my uncle that I wished to go to the bazaar in the evening. He was fussing at the hole stand, looking for the hat brush, and answered me curtly,
"Yes, boy, I know."
As he was in the hall, I could not go into the front parlor and lie at the window. I left the house in bad humor and walked slowly towards the school. The air was pitilessly raw, and already my heart misgave me. When I came home to dinner, my uncle had not yet been home. Still, it was early. I sat staring at the clock for some time, and when its ticking began to irritate me, I left the room. I mounted the staircase and gained the upper part of the house. The high, cold, empty, gloomy rooms liberated me, and I went from room to room, singing. From the front window, I saw my companions playing below in the street. Their cries reached me weakened and indistinct, and leaning my forehead against the cool glass, I looked over at the dark house where she lived. I may have stood there for an hour, seeing nothing but the brown-clad figure cast by my imagination, touched discreetly by the lamplight, at the curved neck, at the hand upon the railings, and at the border below the dress. When I came downstairs again, I found Mrs. Mercer sitting at the fire. She was an old garrulous woman, a pawnbroker's widow, who collected used stamps for some pious purpose. I had to endure the gossip of the tea table. The meal was prolonged beyond an hour, and still my uncle did not come. Mrs. Mercer stood up to go. She was sorry she couldn't wait any longer, but it was after 8 o'clock, and she did not like to be out late, as the night air was bad for her. When she had gone, I began to walk up and down the room, clenching my fists. My aunt said, "I'm afraid you may put off your bazaar for this night of our Lord." At 9 o'clock, I heard my uncle's latchkey in the hall door. I heard him talking to himself, and heard the hall stand rocking when it had received the weight of his overcoat. I could interpret these signs. When he was midway through his dinner, I asked him to give me the money to go to the bazaar. He had forgotten.
"The people are in beds and after their first sleep now," he said.
I did not smile. My aunt said to him energetically,
"Can't you give him the money and let him go? You've kept him late enough as it is."
My uncle said he was very sorry he had forgotten. He said he believed in the old saying, "All work and no play makes Jack a dull boy." He asked me where I was going, and when I had told him a second time, he asked me, did I know the Arab's farewell to his steed? When I left the kitchen, he was about to recite the opening lines of the piece to my aunt. I held a florin tightly in my hand as I strode down Buckingham Street towards the station. The sight of the streets thronged with buyers and glaring with gas recalled to me the purpose of my journey. I took my seat in a third-class carriage of a deserted train. After an intolerable delay, the train moved out of the station, slowly. It crept onward among ruinous houses and over the twinkling river. At Western Row Station, a crowd of people pressed to the carriage doors, but the porters moved them back, saying it was a special train for the bazaar. I remained alone in the bare carriage. In a few minutes, the train drew up beside an improvised wooden platform. I passed out onto the road and saw by the lighted dial of a clock that it was 10 minutes to 10. In front of me was a large building which displayed the magical name. I could not find any sixpenny entrance, and fearing that the bazaar would be closed, I passed in quickly through a turnstile, handing a shilling to a weary-looking man. I found myself in a big hall, girdled at half its height by a gallery. Nearly all the stalls were closed, and the greater part of the hall was in darkness. I recognized a silence like that which pervades a church after a service. I walked into the center of the bazaar, timidly. A few people were gathered about the stalls, which were still open. Before a curtain, over which the words Café Chantant were written in colored lamps, two men were counting money on a salver. I listened to the fall of the coins. Remembering with difficulty why I had come, I went over to one of the stalls and examined porcelain vases and flower tea sets. At the door of the stall, a young lady was talking and laughing with two young gentlemen. I remarked their English accents and listened vaguely to their conversation.
"Oh, I never said such a thing." "Oh, but you did." "Oh, but I didn't. Didn't you say that?" "Yes, I heard her." "Oh, there's a fib."
Observing me, the young lady came over and asked me, did I wish to buy anything? The tone of her voice was not encouraging. She seemed to have spoken to me out of a sense of duty. I looked humbly at the great jars that stood like eastern guards at either side of the dark entrance to the stall, and murmured, "No, thank you." The young lady changed the position of one of the vases and went back to the two young men. They began to talk of the same subject. Once or twice the young lady glanced at me over her shoulder. I lingered before her stall, though I knew my stay was useless, to make my interest in her wares seem the more real. Then I turned away slowly and walked down the middle of the bazaar. I allowed the 2 pennies to fall against the sixpence in my pocket. I heard a voice call from one end of the gallery that the light was out. The upper part of the hall was now completely dark. Gazing up into the darkness, I saw myself as a creature driven and derided by vanity, and my eyes burned with anguish and anger. The the boarding house. Mrs. Mooney was a butcher's daughter. She was a woman who was quite able to keep things to herself, a determined woman. She had married her father's foreman and opened a butcher's shop near Spring Gardens. But as soon as his father-in-law was dead, Mr. Mooney began to go to the devil. He drank, plundered the till, ran headlong into debt. It was no use making him take the pledge. He'd be sure to break out again a few days after. By fighting his wife in the presence of customers, and by buying bad meat, he ruined his business. One night, he went for his wife with a cleaver, and she had to sleep in a neighbor's house. After that, they lived apart. She went to the priest and got a separation from him with care of the children. She would give him neither money nor food nor house room. And so he was obliged to enlist himself as a sheriff's man. He was a shabby, stooped little drunkard, with a white face and a white moustache and white eyebrows penciled above his little eyes, which were pink-veined and raw. And all day long he sat in the bailiff's room, waiting to be put on a job. Mrs. Mooney, who had taken what remained of her money out of the butcher's business and set up a boarding house in Hardwick Street, was a big, imposing woman. Her house had a floating population made up of tourists from Liverpool and the Isle of Man, and occasionally artistes from the music halls. Its resident population was made up of clerks from the city. She governed the house cunningly and firmly, knew when to give credit, when to be stern, and when to let things pass. All the resident young men spoke of her as the madam. Mrs. Mooney's young men paid 15 shillings a week for board and lodgings, beer or stout at dinner excluded. They shared in common tastes and occupations, and for this reason they were very chummy with one another. They discussed with one another the chances of favourites and outsiders. Jack Mooney, the madam's son, who was a clerk to a commission agent in Fleet Street, had a reputation for being a hard case. He was fond of using soldiers' obscenities. Usually he came home in the small hours. When he met his friends, he always had a good one to tell them, and he was always sure to be onto a good thing, that is to say, a likely horse or a likely artiste. He was also handy with the mitts and sang comic songs. On Sunday nights, there would often be a reunion in Mrs. Mooney's front drawing room. The music hall artistes would oblige, and Sheridan played waltzes and polkas and vamped accompaniments. Polly Mooney, the madam's daughter, would also sing. She sang, "I'm a noshy girl, you needn't sham, you know I am." Polly was a slim girl of 19. She had light, soft hair and a small, full mouth. Her eyes, which were grey with a shade of green through them, had a habit of glancing upwards when she spoke with anyone, which made her look like a little perverse Madonna. Mrs. Mooney had first sent her daughter to be a typist in a corn factor's office, but as a disreputable sheriff's man used to come every other day to the office asking to be allowed to say a word to his daughter, she had taken her daughter home again and set her to do housework. As Polly was very lively, the intention was to give her the run of the young men. Besides, young men like to feel that there's a young woman not very far away. Polly, of course, flirted with the young men. But Mrs. Mooney, who was a shrewd judge, knew that the young men were only passing the time away. None of them meant business. Things went on so for a long time, and Mrs. Mooney began to think of sending Polly back to typewriting when she noticed that something was going on between Polly and one of the young men. She watched the pair and kept her own counsel. Polly knew that she was being watched, but still her mother's persistent silence could not be misunderstood. There had been no open complicity between mother and daughter, no open understanding, but though people in the house began to talk of the affair, still Mrs. Mooney did not intervene. Polly began to grow a little strange in her manner, and the young man was evidently perturbed. At last, when she had judged it to be the right moment, Mrs. Mooney intervened. She dealt with moral problems as a cleaver deals with meat, and in this case she had made up her mind. It was a bright Sunday morning of early summer, promising heat, but with a fresh breeze blowing. All the windows of the boarding house were open, and the lace curtains ballooned gently towards the street beneath the raised sashes. The belfry of George's church sent out constant peals, and worshippers, singly or in groups, traversed the little circus before the church, revealing their purpose by their self-contained demeanour no less than by the little volumes in their gloved hands. Breakfast was over in the boarding house, and the table of the breakfast room was covered with plates on which lay yellow streaks of egg with morsels of bacon fat and bacon rind. Mrs. Mooney sat in the straw armchair and watched the servant, Mary, remove the breakfast things. She made Mary collect the crusts and pieces of broken bread to help to make Tuesday's bread pudding. When the table was cleared, the broken bread collected, the sugar and butter safe under lock and key, she began to reconstruct the interview that she had had the night before with Polly. Things were as she had suspected. She had been frank in her questions, and Polly had been frank in her answers. Both had been somewhat awkward, of course. She had been made awkward by her not wishing to receive the news in too cavalier a fashion, or to seem to have connived, and Polly had been made awkward, not merely because allusions of that kind always made her awkward, but also because she did not wish it to be thought that in her wise innocence she had divined the intention behind her mother's tolerance. Mrs. Mooney glanced instinctively at the little gilt clock on the mantelpiece, as soon as she had become aware, through her reverie, that the bells of George's church had stopped ringing. It was 11:17. She would have lots of time to have the matter out with Mr. Doran, and then catch short 12 at Marlborough Street. She was sure she would win. To begin with, she had all the weight of social opinion on her side. She was an outraged mother. She had allowed him to live beneath her roof, assuming that he was a man of honour, and he had simply abused her hospitality. He was 34 or 35 years of age, so that youth could not be pleaded as his excuse. Nor could ignorance be his excuse, since he was a man who had seen something of the world. He had simply taken advantage of Polly's youth and inexperience, that was evident. The question was, what reparation would he make? There must be reparation made in such cases. It's all very well for the man. He can go his ways as if nothing had happened, having had his moment of pleasure, but the girl has to bear the brunt. Some mothers would be content to patch up such an affair for a sum of money. She had known cases of it, but she would not do so. For her, only one reparation could make up for the loss of her daughter's honour. Marriage. She counted all her cards again before sending Mary up to Mr. Doran's room to say that she wished to speak with him. She felt sure she would win. He was a serious young man, not rakish or loud-voiced like the others. If it had been Mr. Sheridan or Mr. Mead or Bantam Lyons, her task would have been much harder. She did not think he would face publicity. All the lodgers in the house knew something of the affair. Details had been invented by some. Besides, he had been employed for 13 years in a great Catholic wine merchant's office, and publicity would mean for him, perhaps, the loss of his job. Whereas, if he agreed, all might be well. She knew that he had a good screw for one thing, and she suspected he had a bit of stuff put by. Nearly the half hour. She stood up and surveyed herself in the pier glass. The decisive expression of her great florid face satisfied her, and she thought of some mothers she knew who could not get their daughters off their hands. Mr. Doran was very anxious indeed this Sunday morning. He had made 2 attempts to shave, but his hand had been so unsteady that he had been obliged to desist. 3 days' reddish beard fringed his jaws, and every 2 or 3 minutes a mist gathered on his glasses, so that he had to take them off and polish them with his pocket handkerchief. The recollection of his confession of the night before was a cause of acute pain to him. The priest had drawn out every ridiculous detail of the affair, and in the end had so magnified his sin that he was almost thankful at being afforded a loophole of reparation. The harm was done. What could he do now but marry her, or run away? He could not brazen it out. The affair would be sure to be talked of, and his employer would be certain to hear of it. Dublin is such a small city, everyone knows everyone else's business. He felt his heart leap warmly in his throat, as he heard in his excited imagination old Mr. Leonard calling out in his rasping voice,
"Send Mr. Doran here, please."
All his long years of service gone for nothing, all his industry and diligence thrown away. As a young man he had sown his wild oats, of course. He had boasted of his free thinking and denied the existence of God to his companions in public houses. But that was all past and done with. Nearly. He still bought a copy of Reynolds' newspaper every week, but he attended to his religious duties and for 9/10 of the year lived a regular life. He had money enough to settle down on. It was not that. But the family would look down on her. First of all, there was her disreputable father, and then her mother's boarding house was beginning to get a certain fame. He had a notion that he was being had. He could imagine his friends talking of the affair and laughing. She was a little vulgar. Sometimes she said, "I seen," and "if I had have known." But what would grammar matter if he really loved her? He could not make up his mind whether to like her or despise her for what she had done. Of course, he had done it too. His instinct urged him to remain free, not to marry. "Once you're married, you're done for," it said. While he was sitting helplessly on the side of the bed in shirt and trousers, she tapped lightly at his door and entered. She told him all, that she had made a clean breast of it to her mother, and that her mother would speak with him that morning. She cried and threw her arms around his neck, saying, "Oh, Bob, Bob, what am I to do? What am I to do at all?" She was put an end to herself, she said. He comforted her feebly, telling her not to cry, that it would be all right, never fear. He felt against his shirt the agitation of her bosom. It was not altogether his fault that it had happened. He remembered well, with the curious, patient memory of the celibate, the first casual caress her dress, her breath, her fingers had given him. Then, late one night, as he was undressing for bed, she had tapped at his door, timidly. She wanted to relight her candle at his, for hers had been blown out by a gust. It was her bath night. She wore a loose, open combing jacket of printed flannel. Her white instep shone in the opening of her furry slippers, and the blood glowed warmly behind her perfumed skin. From her hands and wrists, too, as she lit and steadied her candle, a faint perfume arose. On nights when he came in very late, it was she who warmed up his dinner. He scarcely knew what he was eating, feeling her beside him alone at night in the sleeping house. And her thoughtfulness. If the night was anywhere cold or wet or windy, there was sure to be a little tumbler of punch ready for him. Perhaps they could be happy together. They used to go upstairs together on tiptoe, each with a candle, and on the third landing exchange reluctant good nights. They used to kiss. He remembered well her eyes, the touch of her hand, and his delirium. But delirium passes. He echoed her phrase, applying it to himself. What am I to do? The instinct of the celibate warned him to hold back, but the sin was there. Even his sense of honor told him that reparation must be made for such a sin. While he was sitting with her on the side of the bed, Mary came to the door and said the missus wanted to see him in the parlor. He stood up to put on his coat and waistcoat, more helpless than ever. When he was dressed, he went over to her to comfort her. It would be all right, never fear. He left her crying on the bed and moaning softly, "Oh, my God!" Going down the stairs, his glasses became so dim with moisture that he had to take them off and polish them. He longed to ascend through the roof and fly away to another country, where he would never hear again of his trouble. And yet a force pushed him downstairs, step by step. The implacable faces of his employer and of the madam stared upon his discomfiture. On the last flight of stairs, he passed Jack Mooney, who was coming up from the pantry nursing two bottles of Bass. They saluted coldly, and the lover's eyes rested for a second or two on a thick bulldog face and a pair of thick, short arms. When he reached the foot of the staircase, he glanced up and saw Jack regarding him from the door of the return room. Suddenly he remembered the night when one of the music hall artists, a little blonde Londoner, had made a rather free allusion to Polly. The reunion had almost been broken up on account of Jack's violence. Everyone tried to quiet him. The music hall artiste, a little paler than usual, kept smiling and saying there was no harm meant,
But Jack kept shouting at him that if any fella tried that sort of a game on with his sister, he'd bloody well put his teeth down his throat. So he would.
Polly sat for a little time on the side of the bed, crying. Then she dried her eyes and went over to the looking-glass. She dipped the end of the towel in the water jug and refreshed her eyes with the cool water. She looked at herself in profile and readjusted a hairpin above her ear. Then she went back to the bed again and sat at the foot. She regarded the pillows for a long time, and the sight of them awakened in her mind secret, amiable memories. She rested the nape of her neck against the cool iron bed rail and fell into a reverie. There was no longer any perturbation visible on her face. She waited on patiently, almost cheerfully, without alarm, her memories gradually giving place to hopes and visions of the future. Her hopes and visions were so intricate that she no longer saw the white pillars on which her gaze was fixed, or remembered that she was waiting for anything. At last, she heard her mother calling. She started to her feet and ran to the banisters.
"Polly! Polly!"
"Yes, Mama."
"Come down, dear. Mr. Norton wants to speak to you."
Then she remembered what she had been waiting for. Clay. The matron had given her leave to go out as soon as the women's tea was over, and Maria looked forward to her evening out. The kitchen was spick and span. The cook said you could see yourself in the big copper boilers. The fire was nice and bright, and on one of the side tables were four very big barm bracks. These barm bracks seemed uncut, but if you went closer, you would see that they had been cut into long, thick, even slices, and were ready to be handed round at tea. Maria had cut them herself. Maria was a very, very small person indeed, but she had a very long nose and a very long chin. She talked a little through her nose, always soothingly,
"Yes, my dear," and "No, my dear."
She was always sent for when the women quarrelled over their tubs, and always succeeded in making peace. One day, the matron had said to her,
"Maria, you are a veritable peacemaker."
And the sub-matron and two of the board ladies had heard the compliment. And Ginger Mooney was always saying what she wouldn't do to the dummy who had charge of the irons if it wasn't for Maria. Everyone was so fond of Maria. The women would have their tea at 6 o'clock, and she would be able to get away before 7.
"From Ballsbridge to the Pillar, 20 minutes. From the Pillar to Drumcondra, 20 minutes. And 20 minutes to buy the things."
She would be there before 8. She took out her purse with the silver clasps and read again the words, "A present from Belfast." She was very fond of that purse because Joe had brought it to her 5 years before, when he and Alfie had gone to Belfast on a Whit Monday trip. In the purse were 2 half-crowns and some coppers. She would have 5 shillings clear after paying the tram fare. What a nice evening they would have, all the children singing. Only she hoped that Joe wouldn't come in drunk. He was so different when he took any drink. Often he had wanted her to go and live with them, but she would have felt herself in the way, though Joe's wife was ever so nice with her. And she had become accustomed to the life of the laundry. Joe was a good fellow. She had nursed him and Alfie too. And Joe used often to say,
"Mama is Mama, but Maria is my proper mother."
After the breakup at home, the boys had got her that position in the Dublin by Lamplight laundry, and she liked it. She used to have such a bad opinion of Protestants, but now she thought they were very nice people, a little quiet and serious, but still very nice people to live with. Then she had her plants in the conservatory, and she liked looking after them. She had lovely ferns and wax plants, and whenever anyone came to visit her, she always gave the visitor 1 or 2 slips from her conservatory. There was one thing she didn't like, and that was the tracts on the walks. But the matron was such a nice person to deal with, so genteel. When the cook told her everything was ready, she went into the women's room and began to pull the big bell. In a few minutes, The women began to come in by twos and threes, wiping their steaming hands in their petticoats and pulling down the sleeves of their blouses over their red steaming arms. They settled down before their huge mugs, which the cook and the dummy filled up with hot tea already mixed with milk and sugar in huge tin cans. Maria superintended the distribution of the balm brack and saw that every woman got her four slices. There was a great deal of laughing and joking during the meal. Lizzie Fleming said Maria was sure to get the ring, and though Fleming had said that for so many Halloweens, Maria had to laugh and say she didn't want any ring, or man either. And when she laughed, her grey-green eyes sparkled with disappointed shyness, and the tip of her nose nearly met the tip of her chin. Then Ginger Mooney lifted up her mug of tea and proposed Maria's health, while all the other women clattered with their mugs on the table, and said she was sorry she hadn't a sup of porter to drink it in. And Maria laughed again, till the tip of her nose nearly met the tip of her chin, until her minute body nearly shook itself asunder, because she knew that Mooney meant well, though, of course, she had the notions of a common woman. But wasn't Maria glad when the women had finished their tea and the cook and the dummy had begun to clear away the tea things? She went into her little bedroom and, remembering that next morning was a mass morning, changed the hand of the alarm from 7 to 6. Then she took off her working skirt and her house boots and laid her best skirt out on the bed and her tiny dress boots beside the foot of the bed. She changed her blouse, too, and as she stood before the mirror, she thought of how she used to dress for Mass on Sunday mornings when she was a young girl, and she looked with quaint affection at the diminutive body which she had so often adorned. In spite of its years, she found it a nice, tidy little body. When she got outside, the streets were shining with rain, and she was glad of her old brown waterproof. The tram was full, and she had to sit on the little stool at the end of the car, facing all the people, with her toes barely touching the floor. She arranged in her mind all she was going to do, and thought how much better it was to be independent and to have your own money in your pocket. She hoped they would have a nice evening. She was sure they would. But she could not help thinking what a pity it was Alfie and Joe were not speaking. They were always falling out now, but when they were boys together, they used to be the best of friends. But such was life. She got out of her tram at the pillar and ferreted her way quickly among the crowds. She went into Downs's cake shop, but the shop was so full of people that it was a long time before she could get herself attended to. She bought a dozen of mixed penny cakes and at last came out of the shop laden with a big bag. Then she thought, what else would she buy? She wanted to buy something really nice. They would be sure to have plenty of apples and nuts. It was hard to know what to buy, and all she could think of was cake. She decided to buy some plum cake, but Downs's plum cake had not enough almond icing on top of it, so she went over to a shop in Henry Street. Here she was a long time in suiting herself, and the stylish young lady behind the counter, who was evidently a little annoyed by her, asked her was it wedding cake she wanted to buy. That made Maria blush and smile at the young lady. But the young lady took it all very seriously and finally cut a thick slice of plum cake, parcelled it up and said, 2 and 4, please. She thought she would have to stand at the Drumcondra tram because none of the young men seemed to notice her, but an elderly gentleman made room for her. He was a stout gentleman, and he wore a brown hard hat. He had a square red face and a greyish moustache. Maria thought he was a colonel-looking gentleman, and she reflected how much more polite he was than the young men who simply stared straight before them. The gentleman began to chat with her about Halloween and the rainy weather. He supposed the bag was full of good things for the little ones and said it was only right that the youngsters should enjoy themselves while they were young. Maria agreed with him and favoured him with demure nods and hems. He was very nice to her, and when she was getting out of the canal bridge, she thanked him and bowed, and he bowed to her and raised his hat and smiled agreeably. And while she was going up along the terrace, bending her tiny head under the rain, she thought how easy it was to know a gentleman, even when he has a drop taken. Everybody said, "Oh, here's Maria," when she came to Joe's house. Joe was there, having come home from business, and all the children had their Sunday dresses on. There were two big girls in from next door, and games were going on. Maria gave the bag of cakes to the eldest boy, Alfie, to divide,
and Mrs. Donnelly said it was too good of her to bring such a big bag of cakes, and made all the children say,
"Thanks, Maria."
But Maria said she had brought something special for Papa and Mama, something they would be sure to like, and she began to look for her plum cake. She tried in Downes's bag, and then in the pockets of her waterproof, and then on the hall stand, but nowhere could she find it. Then she asked all the children, had any of them eaten it? By mistake, of course, but the children all said no, and looked as if they did not like to eat cakes if they were to be accused of stealing. Everybody had a solution for the mystery, and Mrs. Donnelly said it was plain that Maria had left it behind her in the tram. Maria, remembering how confused the gentleman with the greyish moustache had made her, coloured with shame and vexation and disappointment. At the thought of the failure of her little surprise and of the 2 and 4 pence she had thrown away for nothing, she nearly cried outright. But Joe said it didn't matter and made her sit down by the fire. He was very nice with her. He told her all that went on in his office, repeating for her a smart answer which he had made to the manager. Maria did not understand why Joe laughed so much over the answer he had made, but she said that the manager must have been a very overbearing person to deal with. Joe said he wasn't so bad, when he knew how to take him, that he was a decent sort so long as you didn't rub him the wrong way. Mrs. Donnelly played the piano for the children, and they danced and sang. Then the 2 next-door girls handed round the nuts. Nobody could find the nutcracker, and Joe was nearly getting cross over it, and asked, how did they expect Maria to crack nuts without a nutcracker? But Maria said she didn't like nuts, and they weren't to bother about her. Then Joe asked, would she take a bottle of stout, and Mrs. Donnelly said there was port wine too in the house, if she'd prefer that. Maria said she would rather they didn't ask her to take anything, but Joe insisted. So Maria let him have his way, and they sat by the fire talking over old times, and Maria thought she would put in a good word for Alfie. But Joe cried that God might strike him stone dead if ever he spoke a word to his brother again, and Maria said she was sorry she'd mentioned the matter. Mrs. Donnelly told her husband it was a great shame for him to speak that way of his own flesh and blood, but Joe said that Alfie was no brother of his, and there was nearly being a row on the head of it. But Joe said he would not lose his temper on account of the night it was, and asked his wife to open some more stout. The 2 next-door girls had arranged some Halloween games, and soon everything was merry again. Maria was delighted to see the children so merry, and Joe and his wife in such good spirits. The next-door girls put some saucers on the table and then led the children up to the table blindfold. One got the prayer book and the other 3 got the water. And when one of the next-door girls got the ring, Mrs. Donnelly shook her finger at the blushing girl as much as to say, "Oh, I know all about it." They insisted then on blindfolding Maria and leading her up to the table to see what she would get. And while they were putting on the bandage, Maria laughed and laughed again till the tip of her nose nearly met the tip of her chin. They led her up to the table amid laughing and joking, and she put her hand out in the air, as she was told to do. She moved her hand about here and there in the air and descended on one of the saucers. She felt a soft, wet substance with her fingers, and was surprised that nobody spoke or took off her bandage. There was a pause for a few seconds, and then a great deal of scuffling and whispering. Somebody said something about the garden, and at last Mrs. Donnelly said something very cross to one of the next-door girls, and told her to throw it out at once. That was no play. Maria understood that it was wrong that time, and so she had to do it over again, and this time she got the prayer book. After that, Mrs. Donnelly played Miss McLeod's reel for the children, and Joe made Maria take a glass of wine. Soon they were all quite merry again, and Mrs. Donnelly said Maria would enter a convent before the year was out because she had got the prayer book. Maria had never seen Joe so nice to her as he was that night, so full of pleasant talk and reminiscences. She said they were all very good to her. At last the children grew tired and sleepy, and Joe asked Maria would she not sing some little song before she went, one of the old songs. Mrs. Donnelly said, "Do please, Maria." And so Maria had to get up and stand beside the piano. Mrs. Donnelly bade the children to be quiet and listen to Maria's song. Then she played the prelude and said, "Now, Maria." And Maria, blushing very much, began to sing in a tiny, quavering voice. She sang,
I dreamt that I dwelt. And when she came to the second verse, she sang again,
I dreamt that I dwelt in marble halls, with vassals and serfs at my side, and all who assembled within those walls, that I was the hope and the pride. I had riches too great to count, could boast of a high ancestral name. But I also dreamt, which pleased me most, that you love me still the same.
But no one tried to show her mistake. And when she had ended her song, Joe was very much moved. He said there was no time like the long ago, and no music for him like poor old Balth, whatever other people might say. And his eyes filled up so much with tears that he could not find what he was looking for. And in the end, he had to ask his wife to tell him where the corkscrew was.